Good morning. We shall begin with today's part, that is metalloporphyrins, what we call as metalloproteins. In this topic, already we have started some 2 days back, that we have seen that there are two types of elements are there. The elements which are absolutely necessary to carry out various metabolic processes are known as essential elements. These elements are absorbed by our body in large quantities and hence are known as major elements or essential elements. There are certain other elements. Those are required in very minute quantities, or the quantity that is required by our body, it is very, very less. Because the quantity that is required is very minute or negligible quantity is there, and hence all such elements are known as trace elements. So this is the main difference between the essential elements and the trace elements. Then we have started with some 30 elements which are needed by our body. We have also seen that due to deficiency or due to absence of either of these elements, certain deficiency defects are created. For example, yesterday we have seen that due to iodine deficiency, goiter-like diseases, those are there. If calcium deficiency is there, our bones, teeth, those become brittle. One cannot stand erect because of deficiency of this calcium. So in addition to this calcium, iron, all other elements are also needed by our body so as to carry out various metabolic processes. Then we have arrived at the role of alkali and alkaline earth metals in biological systems. As the name of the topic itself suggests, that the study of metals and non-metals in biological systems is known as the bioenvironchemistry, as we know. Now, we have studied the role of alkali metals and alkaline earth metals. Alkali metals, in this regard, we have seen sodium and potassium, which belongs to first A group of the periodic table. And then we have seen the calcium, which belongs to alkaline earth metal, as we know. Today, we are going to begin with a very important aspect of this topic, that is known as the metalloporphyrins or metalloproteins. Basically, metalloproteins or metalloporphyrins are nothing but these are the proteins which are present in our body. So we are going to study two different types of metalloproteins or metalloporphyrins. One is known as a hemoglobin and another is known as a myoglobin. But the study of myoglobin is not expected from you in detail, but I would like to highlight more points on hemoglobin too, because hemoglobin is very important part of our body. That is, it is a very important part of our blood cell. We know that metalloproteins or metalloporphyrins, these are the proteins containing an active center. This sentence is very important, that metalloproteins or metalloporphyrins, these contains an active center called porphyrin. I am going to show very soon how the active center, that is a porphyrin structure, can be drawn and to which a metal ion and the variety of side chains are attached. So an active center that is known as a porphyrin, to which a metal atom along with variety of side chains are attached. Such a complex structure is known as the metalloporphyrin. So metallo means containing metal, porphyrin means proteins. Porphyrin contains four chiral rings joined by double bonds. I am going to show you how this is joined by a double bonds. Porphyrin in combination with iron form the most important biologically active compounds such as hemoglobin and myoglobin. But just now I have mentioned that the study of myoglobin is not expected in more details. Just I would like to mention that these are the two biologically active compounds wherein the metalloporphyrins play a very important role. We know our normal adult contains about 5 liters of blood. The blood contains about 4 grams of iron. So without iron, human life is not at all possible, because whatever the red color of blood is there, it is only because of the complex of iron that is known as a hemoglobin. Now, what is the main function of hemoglobin? As we have studied from our school level, that hemoglobin transfers oxygen from lungs to body tissues. So the main function of hemoglobin is to carry or is to transport oxygen from lungs to body tissues. Also, in addition to this transportation, hemoglobin also carries the oxygen to myoglobin also, because myoglobin also requires oxygen for its various processes. So from lungs to body tissues or from lungs to muscles, the hemoglobin plays a very important role of transporting this oxygen. Now, hemoglobin exists in two different forms, as we know. One form that is known as a deoxyhemoglobin, another is known as a oxyhemoglobin. What is this deoxyhemoglobin? Hemoglobin molecule without oxygen is known as a deoxyhemoglobin. So when hemoglobin is deprived of oxygen or there is absence of oxygen, then it is known as a deoxyhemoglobin. And oxyhemoglobin means hemoglobin molecule along with a dioxygen or oxygen is known as a oxyhemoglobin. Let us study the structure of the hemoglobin. I think perhaps you might have studied the structure of this hemoglobin. I would like to show you this structure. Just see the structure of hemoglobin, then we shall study what is this deoxyhemoglobin and oxyhemoglobin. So see the structure for this hemoglobin. As we know that we are studying the metalloporphyrins. As we are studying the metalloporphyrins, which are also regarded as the metalloproteins, in which we are studying two types of hemoglobin, that is a oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin. Now, first of all, I would like to draw the complicated structure of a heme unit, which is very complicated, but in simpler forms, how can we draw this structure? As we know, these proteins contains a metal ion to which a variety of side chains are attached. Here, these are the four nitrogen atoms of a pyrrol ring. Perhaps you might be knowing that pyrrol ring is a five-membered ring structure. So these are the five pyrrol rings, where these are the nitrogen atoms of the pyrrol ring, where if we join all these corners, then the structure becomes again very much complicated. Now here, these are the double bonds. Here again, there is a double bond. And again, here, this is a pyrrol ring where CH double bond CH2, this is a CH3. Again, this is a CH3. You have to see this structure very carefully, because I have drawn this structure in simpler format so that you can draw this structure at very, very leisure time and easily. This is again CH2, CH2, and C double bond O. Again, there is a double bond. Here, again, there is a double bond. For this pyrrol ring, this is a double bond. And again here, CH3. And for this pyrrol ring, this is CH3. And this is CH2. So this is known as the structure of the heme unit, where iron is located at the center, and this iron is captured by the nitrogen atoms from the pyrrol ring. So this contains four pyrrol rings, where this iron is chelated inside the vicinity or the empty space. So this is known as a pyrrol ring. So based on this primary structure, we have to study further that what is a deoxyhemoglobin. Now, the structure, same structure that can be drawn also like this. This is as per our chemistry knowledge, but in simpler terms, the structure of hemoglobin molecule can also be shown as like this. Here, this is an animated structure for the better understanding of how hemoglobin molecule exists, which contains the four pyrrole rings. So this is, this can be shown as like this. For this pyrrole ring, again, this is a globin chain. Here we can show again, for this chain, again, we can show this as like this. And for this, can be shown as like this. So four heme groups are there. So this is known as, this is known as a pyrrole ring. You should remember this pyrrole ring, which I have shown here. This is a pyrrole ring, which I have shown in some different form, where at the center ferrous ion is captured. This is known as the histidine group. This is known as a histidine group, which is joined to a coiled globin chain. And this is a heme group. At the center, heme group is there. So iron along with heme group means Fe plus 2 ferrous ion. Iron along with this coiled globin chain, hence it is known as a hemoglobin. So here the histidine group can be shown as like this. This is nitrogen from histidine group, and a double bond is there. This is carbon and this is a hydrogen, and CH2. This is again attached to a globin chain. So here all these four groups, those are attached to histidine group. So this is a simpler form of this hemoglobin molecule. Now, based on this knowledge, if we look at the structure of the hemoglobin and the oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin, we can show this as like this. Now, based on this theory that is known as a Kusselfield theory, we are very well familiar with the Kusselfield theory. Here, hemoglobin molecule, I shall write HB, it is universally accepted abbreviation, hemoglobin molecule without oxygen is known as deoxyhemoglobin. You should remember that hemoglobin molecule without oxygen is known as a deoxyhemoglobin. In deoxyhemoglobin, the ferrous ion, this ferrous ion in porphyrin ring, I think you are very well familiar with the porphyrin ring. In deoxyhemoglobin, the ferrous ion in porphyrin ring is pentacoordinated. It is a pentacoordinated. Say, for example, I would like to show you this porphyrin ring. These are the nitrogen atoms from the porphyrin ring. Here, here, if we show a five-membered ring like this, there are five-membered rings of porphyrin are there like this. If I draw the entire structure, the structure becomes very difficult and complicated to understand. So here, this is known as a porphyrin ring. In the center, there is a porphyrin ring. Ferrous ion is a pentacoordinated. So here, this is a ferrous ion, which is a pentacoordinated. What is a pentacoordinated? This is position number 1, position number 2, 3, 4, and 5. So here, iron is at the fifth coordinating site. So first, second, third, fourth, and fifth. So for this purpose, I have used the word the pentacoordinated. So in case of deoxyhemoglobin, iron is in pentacoordinated state and it is having almost a square planar structure. So this is a square planar structure where four corners of a square plane are occupied by nitrogen atoms and iron is at the top. And because here it is having a square pyramidal structure, it is square pyramidal because it is at the top of the ring. So this is in a square pyramidal structure and it is in high spin state. It is in high spin state. What is a high spin state? For example, as we know, iron having atom number 26. In terms of argon core, we can write the electronic configuration for this as a 4s2 3d6. Now, in this case, iron is in plus 2 oxidation state. So to arrive at a plus 2 oxidation state, iron must lose these two electrons and one of the electron from this. So it should lose only two electrons to show plus 2 oxidation state. So for ferrous ion, it is in D6 case. Now, if weak ligand field is there, the d electrons, those can be distributed in terms of T2g and Eg orbitals. How can we distribute? Because when weak ligand field is there, the energy gap between T2g and Eg is very, very small. So out of 6 electrons, first 5 electrons, they occupy singly. And the 6th electron gets paired up here. So in case of deoxyhemoglobin, the distribution of 6 electrons is T2G4 and Ag2. And these two Eg orbitals are nothing but Dx square, Mesa square and Dz square. Because ferrous ion contains a single electron in its Dx square, Mesa square orbital, so this ferrous ion is in big size and having the dimension of about 92 picometers. So such big size ferrous ion cannot be accommodated by this porphyrin ring. So it is about 80 picometers outside the porphyrin ring plane. So because iron contains a single electron in its d x square minus y square orbital, it is a big in size and hence such big size ferrous ion cannot be accommodated by the porphyrin ring and hence it is about 80 picometers outside the ring plane. So this is about the deoxyhemoglobin. Here the point to be remembered that ferrous ion in porphyrin ring plane is pentacoordinated as it can be seen from this structure. Secondly, because it occupies the 5th coordinating site, it is having a square pyramidal shape where iron is in high spin state. Why it is high spin? Because 4 electrons are unpaired. So spin is increased, hence it is known as a high spin state. That means it is also in paramagnetic state. That means because of 4 unpaired electrons, it becomes paramagnetic. So the 6 electrons in case of deoxyhemoglobin are distributed as a T2G4 and Eg2. And because of its big size, it is about 80 picometers outside the porphyrin ring plane. Now, come to oxyhemoglobin. I shall write this as a oxy, HB means oxyhemoglobin. So, I would like to show you again the porphyrin ring plane like this. These are the nitrogen atoms from the porphyrin ring, that is from pyrrole ring. And when this ferrous ion is at the top, and here we can show the attachment of this. When hemoglobin molecule with oxygen is there, it is known as oxyhemoglobin, or when it is attached to dioxygen, it is known as oxyhemoglobin. Now, what are the peculiarities of oxyhemoglobin? Now, when hemoglobin is attached to oxygen, it forms a deoxyhemoglobin. It forms a oxyhemoglobin because oxygen is present. Oxygen binds at the 6th coordinating position. What is the 6th coordinating position? Because as we know in the previous structure, this is the 5th coordinating site. And at the 6th coordinating site, at this point, the oxygen is attached. Because oxygen or dioxygen is attached at 6th coordinating site, the structure is regarded as an octahedral structure. So, because it gives octahedral structure, and because of presence of this oxygen atom, now the six electrons from the ferrous ion, how they are distributed? Again, here these are the T2g group of orbitals and these are the pg group of orbitals. Now, as our primary knowledge of Russell field theory, the energy gap between T2g and eg is very very large when strong ligands are there. So oxygen acts as a strong ligand in this case, because strong ligands interact with the ferrous ion very strongly, because of which there is a large energy gap. Because large energy gap is there, now the question arises, how can we place the six electrons? Out of six electrons, first of all, according to above principle, three electrons occupy singly. Now remaining three electrons either are to be placed from these three electrons, two electrons to be placed in Eg and one electron in T2g. But because there is a large energy gap between T2g and Eg group of orbitals, very less amount of energy is required to pair those electrons. So fourth, fifth and sixth electron goes to T2g group of orbitals. So six electrons are distributed as like this. So in case of oxyhemoglobin, the Eg orbitals do not contain any electrons, and hence because of this, the ferrous ion is very very small in size. So this small size ferrous ion, it is having the radius of about 75 picometers. So it is just only 12 picometers outside the porphyrin ring plane. So when deoxyhemoglobin at this point, that is sixth coordinating site, when oxygen gets attached, it causes the spin pairing, and because of spin pairing, it becomes low spin. And because it is a low spin, due to absence of unpaired electrons, it becomes diamagnetic. So all the electron gets paired up, and no electrons are there in Eg group of orbitals, and hence this ferrous ion in oxyhemoglobin is very very small in size. And at the sixth coordinating site, oxygen get attached, which forms a strong ligand field, and because of which this ferrous ion goes in the vicinity of porphyrin ring plane. In doing so, it also moves the histidine group also, which is also hydrogen bonded, to other four subunits. For example, I would like to show you again like this. This is structure. So when one subunit picks up oxygen, here iron is there, everywhere iron is there, but when one subunit picks up oxygen, this ferrous ion goes inside the vicinity of porphyrin ring plane, which changes the conformation in the globin chain, which is hydrogen bonded to all other four subunits. So because hemoglobin molecule is made up of four subunits, which I have shown here, when one subunit picks up an oxygen molecule, ferrous ion contracts. So the ferrous ion gets contracted and moves into the plane of the ring. In doing so, it moves the histidine molecule attached to it and causes the conformational changes in the molecule, and that changes in the molecule also changes the conformational changes in this globin chain also. So the structure is again disturbed, or certain conformational changes takes place, and because conformational changes takes place, this increases because of ferrous ion that moves inside, that increases the tendency to attract oxygen. This increases the tendency to attract oxygen. This is known as cooperative effect. This tendency is known as a cooperative effect. So you should remember this word. Why this is called cooperative effect? Because when one subunit picks up oxygen, then ferrous ion gets contracted. Why it becomes contracted? Because that causes, here, you see here again, because when one subunit picks up oxygen, this oxygen acts as a strong ligand and Eg orbitals become zero. No electrons are there, and hence such ferrous ion in oxyhemoglobin is very very small in size. So this small size ferrous ion gets inside this porphyrin plane. In doing so, it causes changes in the globin chain. And because there are certain conformational changes which enhances the ability of this hemoglobin molecule to attract oxygen that increases, this is known as the cooperative effect. This is known as a cooperative effect. And this tendency of hemoglobin to attract oxygen decreases with decrease in pH. This is known as a Bohr effect. So these are the two different phenomena. Those take place simultaneously. So you should remember certain points that I am going to repeat once again, because these are the two structures which are very, very important from the examination point of view, because so many MCQ based or long time questions have been asked during exam. So we shall compare both the molecules. So first molecule is a deoxyhemoglobin. Another is known as a oxyhemoglobin. Deoxyhemoglobin means hemoglobin molecule without oxygen is known as a deoxyhemoglobin. Here, oxyhemoglobin, hemoglobin molecule with oxygen is known as a oxyhemoglobin. In case of deoxyhemoglobin, second point, this ferrous ion, which is having D6 configuration, where the T2g orbital containing 4 electrons, Eg orbital containing 2 electrons, and because of this, the Eg orbital, particularly dx square minus y square orbital, contain a single electron, and because of which this is having a big size. Size is about 92 picometers. Such big sized ferrous ion cannot be accommodated that by the porphyrin ring plane, and ferrous ion that is present at the fifth coordinating site, which gives a square pyramidal structure or square pyramidal geometry to the molecule. And here, this is a, all these facts are true for this deoxyhemoglobin. Another point that I would like to mention here, because there are 4 unpaired electrons are there, and hence deoxyhemoglobin molecule is paramagnetic. You should bear in mind why it is paramagnetic, because no ligand is present, only free ferrous ion is there, and because of which the Eg orbital containing, that is the dx square minus y square orbital containing a single electron, hence it is having very big size. So it is about 80 picometers outside the porphyrin ring plane. So all these points are true for the deoxyhemoglobin. Now here come to oxyhemoglobin. Here, in case of oxyhemoglobin, the ferrous ion is at the fifth coordinating site, in addition to which oxygen also binds at the sixth coordinating site, which gives a octahedral shape to oxyhemoglobin. And because oxygen acts as a strong ligand, it causes spin pairing in Eg orbitals, and hence the D6 electrons are now distributed as P2G6 and Eg0. So no electrons are present in Eg orbitals, and hence ferrous ion in oxyhemoglobin is very, very small, having the diameter about 72 picometers. So this small ferrous ion that moves inside the vicinity of porphyrin ring plane, and it is just about 12 picometers outside the porphyrin ring plane. So when this ferrous ion picks up, when one subunit picks up oxygen, then that causes spin pairing, and because of which this oxyhemoglobin becomes diamagnetic. So these are the points of differences. Now, based on this knowledge, we have to define the cooperative effect. So when one subunit picks up oxygen, which binds at sixth coordinating site, The ferrous ion that moves inside the vicinity of porphyrin plane, in doing so, it causes certain conformational changes. What is the conformational changes? There are structural, major structural changes that takes place. And because the conformational changes take place that disturb the structure, and because of this, the tendency of oxyhemoglobin molecule to attract the oxygen that increases, that is known as the cooperative effect. The tendency of hemoglobin molecule to attract oxygen that increases, it is known as a cooperative effect. And this tendency of hemoglobin molecule to attract oxygen decreases with a decrease in pH, that is known as the Bohr effect. So these are exactly reverse to each other. So this is how we have studied today two important metalloporphyrins, which are the hemoglobin and the myoglobin. I have not gone into details of this myoglobin because only the structure of hemoglobin in terms of deoxy and oxyhemoglobin, that is very, very important. So only 2 minutes are left, but I want to make an important announcement that tomorrow we are having a webinar. Everybody should join on Zoom link. I am going to share the Zoom link on the group. You have to join because after completion of your BSc, what are the features which are available, or what are the opportunities which are available for you after completing your BSc? Because one person is there, he is master, he is from Pune, and he 2 days back he called me and asked me to join all the students so that he will give you certain ideas regarding your future career. Because we know that some of the students, they got distinction mark, but they failed to appear or they failed to crack the interview. But some students, they are only just second class students, but they crack the interview. So he is also going to tell you how to crack the interview effectively and confidently. So you all should join. I think there may be, you have to join 3 times the Zoom link, because he is going to arrange the lecture for about 1.5 hours. So everybody should join. No student should left the meeting in between. So tomorrow at 10:30, you have to join the webinar. Thank you. Thank you very much.